Hey everybody, and welcome back to Kerbal Space Program RP0. We are picking up once again on Mars, right where we left off as we were arriving to our resupply pod and the very, very delicate operation that is required to extract that engine. So, well, I'll let Oldie take it. Alright, so, yeah, we're going to establish independent comms with Earth so we can radio in some of the science data. It's always nice to double up because we still have that lab in orbit that we're going to take full advantage of. So 400 science. Oh, that's awesome. And it uploads super quick. That is even better. So we'll just take another one of these and keep it. We'll use that for running through the laboratory later, and I guess while we have control from in here, we might as well run what we can. Yeah, nothing worth transmitting. We'll just go ahead and keep that one, and I'm sure we can bring it back to the lab. Oh, review data. Okay. Seismic scan from the Midlands. We'll transmit that because we can get a replacement copy when we get back home. And another one, review data on micrometeorite just from Mars' surface. This is not biome-specific. That's very interesting. Well, we'll grab another one and Geiger counter from Mars' highlands. So we'll just log and, oh yes, 90 science for transmitting this, 200 for bringing it home. I wonder how much we'll get for running it through a lab. Excellent. So, review. I already did this one, didn't I? Yeah, whatever. Let's just keep it. And oh yeah, analyze telemetry. Oh, we've already got one in here. What do we got? Well, I'm willing to bet it was from Mars Midlands so that we can just redo it anyway. So we'll transmit a copy home. We'll keep a copy. I already did that one. Where am I today? Log seismic, keep. Log rads, keep. Record impact, keep. There we go. So all of our instruments are full. We can deactivate this because otherwise we drain the hell out of our batteries. So, Laura Douglas, this is the very, very critical part of your mission. So let's get to it. And let's get to it in time warp, because the first thing she has to do is collect all of these science-y data bits, including grabbing another EVA report from the surface. So we'll just, we can't quite get close enough to collect the data on that one, but we can reach it to relocate it and then grab the data. That's always awesome. And due to some interesting routing issues with this being a copy, the engine bell is actually the root part. And I would like to keep this little adapter and not let it touch the ground. There we go. Fantastic. Engine is secured, and all done while literally laying down on the job. That is a talented engineer. So, I do also want to collect this core and maybe this other tank, because the way we have this rover set up currently is not exactly sustainable. We need to be able to relocate that life support tank onto other systems. Namely, we need to put it on the base to refill it, and then put it on the ascent stage to make sure our crew can breathe long enough to get back to Harmonia Station. This air brake I would also like to keep because I think it'll make a fantastic jack stand. But first things first, we need to get these bits off and attached somewhere. I would have liked to have done something a little more uniform, but just based on the way things are in attachment nodes, it's just easier to slap them right there on the side. We'll come back and grab this air brake, set it down, and poof. Well, that's just nice, isn't it? Yeah. Anyway, I guess we have collected all the parts we actually need. The engine bell, the adapter plate, which needs to be rerouted if we're going to get any actual use out of it, and that gimbal just wiggling away, an extra fuel tank, and an avionics core. Fantastic. So the very first thing we're going to do in our extraordinarily sped up bit of footage is plot a very careful course home. I guess I kind of realized that now that we have the wheel settings correct, as long as we can keep ourselves on a good part of a hill, we can get home without incident, which is pretty phenomenal, I'd have to say. So I've sped all of this up a great deal. I think 8x. I sped it up four times, and I sped the four times footage up four times again, so I guess it's bet up 64 times. Whatever, you can do the math all on your own. That's what I'm not, that's not at all what I'm here for. But I mean, that sounds about right. This was probably 3.5-4 hours worth of footage, which I have condensed down to, you know, less than 10 minutes. Pretty good. So this drive turned out to be exceptionally smooth, although I wish I had taken the camera off of follow mode, because it does kind of make this whole experience a little more jostling than I would have liked, and really the scenery was quite pretty. So having the landscape stay static while the rover kind of bounced around probably would have been a little more aesthetically pleasing, at least for these like detached pan away shots. The closer, tighter in shots where it looks like you're attached to the rover, this probably would have worked, but not sped up to this degree. But I don't know, entirely semantical. But yeah, like I said, I also reduced the travel speed from 13 meters per second to 12 meters per second, which made things a lot more tolerable as far as losing control of the rover, etc., etc., and all of the necessary bouncing and stuff like that. Quick break there just to take a quick save, and we'll change our camera angle for this leg. We did manage to avoid any flippy ovary incidents, which was especially crucial because we have a mission critical engine bell sitting on the back of our rover that is in kind of a precarious spot. If we were to flip the right way, we could absolutely lose that thing, and that would be, you know, bad-ish. Defeat the whole point of this entire drive, which would make me really, really depressed. So, you know, at least there's that. And, yeah, again, I should have detached the camera from locked view or whatever, because I have to apologize. I'm just kind of watching this as I'm recording the voiceover, and it's, you know, it bounces a lot. The camera certainly does shake and wiggle. It's a little disjointing, and I apologize. But most of this was done with me not sitting here babysitting it for a change, which was absolutely phenomenal. I was able to actually get things done, take the doggos for a walk, spend some time with Baby Crash. All in all, it was a very nice, relaxing recording session that I paid absolutely no attention to. Unlike the torturous adventure that was the trip out here. But now that I think I've figured out kind of the formula between the wheel traction control, wheel friction, speed, and how to plot a nice gentle course that involves very few diving off of cliffs kind of things, I think we've got a pretty good recipe for extended rover journeys. Which really, I can only think of maybe one or two more very small rover trips this little guy is going to take, because I do not think that we are within even a couple of 100 kilometers of another biome that is not the Highlands. Of course, we just kind of lucked into by landing at the base of a very interesting volcano, which I'm sure is extraordinarily scientifically significant to all of the top-tier researchers back at the CCSA facilities on Earth. But as far as being able to gather a whole metric crap ton of data for this particular mission, yeah, no, not so much. Both of these biomes have been visited either by a crew or by a probe in the past. And, oh, man, yeah, fighting with the hill, that's just unpleasant. So, unfortunately, our data returns are rather minuscule considering the, I don't know, cost and stress of actually performing this whole mission. So, you know, there's that. But there is what would have been a fantastic view of Tharsis Tolis. Really hoping I got that right. If the camera weren't so absolutely tragic. A quick replot of a few of our nodes just to make sure that we don't go diving into a very steep ravine, and trying to limit some of this combating the hill as much as I can, and renaming this rover officially to Duster 1, because I think Laura Douglas has decided it needs its own call sign based on the utility of this thing and the fact that we pretty much built it from the ground up out of scrap in situ. Well, considering she built it from the ground up in situ, I think she has earned the right to give it a name. So, Duster One it is, and Duster One is making absolutely fantastic time across some of these very hilly regions here at the base of the volcano. Now moving across, and only 3/4 of the way through her return leg on this trip, which, thank goodness, has been very uneventful, but extraordinarily scenic. The few times I popped my head in to check on this little guy while it was making this trip were nicely rewarded. I promise you, this looks a whole lot better when the footage isn't sped up to quite this degree. Although, I guess, not that you'd know it or anything like that. But making exceptionally good time. Probably pretty hard to have a mid-road trip snack while wearing a spacesuit. Although I wonder if she could like retract her arm inside the body of the suit and move it up through the neck collar. Or if we have some special EVA surface suits. That would be neat. But yeah, I just kind of realized she can't really have a very easy access to a snack for this entire drive. And she's been working almost nonstop for like 2 straight days in a spacesuit outside of the habitat. Well, one, there's got to be a lot of dust and grime and dirt lodged in all the nooks and crannies of that spacesuit. And, I don't know, maybe she should call her union rep or something. These are terrible, terrible working conditions. And, yeah, this would have been a much better view had I unlocked the camera. I've learned something today. A few things, rather. All the things we've covered, really. And detach the camera mode when you're doing these long, detached, kind of pan-back shots. They don't work this way. Well, oh well. So, yeah, this is another big, long stretch where I was obviously absentee, or present me would have moved the mouse cursor off the field of view. And, well, now, there's no saving this whole sequence, so I guess it really doesn't matter. We could be irritated about the mouse pointer. We could be irritated about how the shot was set up to begin with, or, you know, how the cinematography was done. Whichever. And why are her headlights on? That doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So at this point, I stepped back in, changed some of the nodes, or the waypoints, I guess is what we're going to call them, and failed to move the mouse pointer again. But, you know, hey, whatever works for you. But we are in the home stretch, probably less than 10 clicks or so to go until we are back home. And she can step inside, probably have a bathroom break that doesn't involve a diaper, and eat a sandwich. A very, very, very well-deserved sandwich. Just, you know, like 9 or 10 more little dunes to go. Yeah, here we are, kind of cresting over the last of it. This is where this kind of shot would work. But again, not sped up to this degree. Those are my own failures. And now we get to combat the hill, and I think we can actually see home base right here in this little dip of a valley. There it is, the ascent stage off to the left-hand side of the screen, home base there on the right. And we'll just go ahead and pull in and have a park. Excellent. Now the, one other very small bit of logistics that we need to attend to as we navigate our still rather cluttery debris field is something that needs attending to out here on the ascent stage. Unfortunately, we do have a lot of work still to do to this thing, although we're not going to be attaching the engine just yet. We will, in fact, get to it sooner, but we should drop off the data we collected here just to make sure, in case we have any duplicates in the habitat, they don't get scrubbed off right away. We can actually put those in the other module of the ascent stage just to make sure that we can get 2 copies up to orbit with us, one to take home and one to run through the lab, even though some of those things probably won't be processed through the laboratory for a few years, and certainly nothing's getting back to the lab before, I don't know, 1995-ish? There she is. Time for a sandwich. She'll take a very quick break before getting back to work the very next day, late in the afternoon, because, you know, if we can't just let her sleep in a little bit after that whole adventure, then, well, what the hell are they working for, right? So, first order of business, boot up the rover, move this antenna over so that we can have a proper self-righting system again. That was just kind of the way things are. And then we need to retask this rover and get that life support module into a place where it is easily accessible. So the very first thing we'll do is move the cockpit onto those tanks, because that's where we need them to be, and then relocate this life support tank to someplace where it can be easily accessed for quick removal. We need to get the avionics core off. We'll just set that to the side, grab this here empty fuel tank, and mount it as haphazardly as we care, and then reattach the cockpit module. Run our wires, run our boot sequence, make sure, you know, that's probably pretty good. Whichever. And then mount our self-righting system here to a node, just so we can have a centered access point to deal with. We should probably turn this light around to something useful, because, you know, we're here. Why not? And then we'll get those two headlights off the cockpit itself, because they were bent up a whole lot in the crash, and it just really does not look right. So for the time being, we're going to get this avionics core over here and attached to the surface base itself. It will create more of a battery draw than that thing is really built to handle. But, you know, whatever. We just need it off the rover for right now, because it is engine installing time. Hallelujah. And this is where the problem of the engine being the root part kind of presents itself, because I wanted to take that adapter plate with us because I would like the engine recessed into the tank above it, as the rest of these are, for ground clearancing reasons. And it's a bad idea to let the engine touch the ground, so we're just going to kind of mount it right here for right now. I mean, ish. Trying to figure out exactly how to do this, because once I detach the two, I cannot reset that offset at all. So, here's old me to be real mad about it. Alright, God, I wish there was a way I could reroute parts on the fly in situ, and I just don't think there is. So, we're going to do really the only option we have to us is to just attach this thing. Oh, it won't give me the top node, because technically the top node is taken up by that little orange tank guy. Alright, well, I'm scared that if I raise the jack stand antennas, it's going to start sliding away from me. So I guess I'm going to have to give up and remove the little orange tank. Any chance of keeping that offset is gone. Yeah, now I have the top node again. Fingers crossed, please don't explode. Okay, I kind of expected it to like bounce up when it registered the collision. Oh, it's stuck. Hold on, let's raise the other side. Nope. That engine bell is keeping it pinned to the ground, and I wonder if when we go to take off, that is either going to cause an explosion, or if we're just not going to be able to take off. Oh, interesting. Alright, well, let's get this thing off. Okay, just set it on the ground. Yeah, you can't attach it, you're too far away. Set it down. Oh, okay, that's a good thing to have just magically render. Okay, I think the antennas took most of that. Oh yeah, good, just go ahead. Be sideways. And we're resting on the engine bells. That's a good sign. Okay, well, nothing blew up, so we're in good shape. God, KSP physics, why are you so weird? All the time, just so weird. All right, so we're going to get that other tank mounted here just because it looks cleaner. And then we're going to get our battery off of the rover and recharge the cells here inside the ascent stage and lock them closed. Because, well, otherwise it will die. That solar panel is not enough. It is also a good way for us to be able to deactivate avionics inside the ascent stage for that little gold core that is actually the root part for all of it. But we'll get back to that a little later. For right now, we're going to do some garbage collection and cleaning as get some of these excessive parts off of our surface installation here and make it a little more cleaned up, a little better looking, I guess. And with use of this rover, now that we have a core, we can actually remote detonate things. So we'll start to gather up all of our garbage sitting around here, and it turns out we can now move hinges around because they have no parent part, or root part is the word I'm looking for, and so therefore can be moved now. Now, attaching things to them or trying to move them creates some rather silly things that happen. And, of course, sliding a docking port on the surface causes it to explode. So there's that. We will deploy this seismic sensor, although I think it's the science it generates is kind of a duplicate of the other seismic sensor we have going on, before deploying our rover out to try to collect the other seismic sensor. I really do not want to attach robotic parts to the rover. A little bit of a bounce because she got stuck in a little crevice there. Yeah, I don't want to attach robotic parts to the rover just in case we can't get them off and we end up blowing it up. I still have some goals in mind for this rover, but our little junk pile is getting a little too heavy to push and our remaining debris field is pretty far flung. So I'm going to turn you over to Old Me for our latest bit of genius engineering. All right, parking should be good enough. Let's leave seat. And then go collect some of the random miscellaneous parts that actually survived our crash landing. Namely this here winch. Let's go ahead and get this out and like it right down here. Which node do we want this on? I guess I want it facing kind of down towards the ground. These are not the most cooperative nodes, are they? Nope. Oh, come on. Oh, really? You have to be node attached? Okay, let's just... I cannot believe this has to be node attached. That is really unfortunate. No, I really... It has to be low enough to where a Kerbal can get to it. There's no node down here? Oh, come on. I know there's a node down here. That's not great. That might be... Well, one, we need to angle it down a whole bunch. I did not like that wiggle, not one little bit. Yeah, this solar panel that is broken, quote-unquote. I really swore up and down there's a node at the, I guess what we're going to call the bottom of this Rovemate rover core that we're wearing as a backpack. Alright, well, you know what? Since those robotic parts detached themselves from these cubic octagonal struts a while ago, we might as well go ahead and use one of these guys. Really? You're just... I wonder what the reference point for this is, because it does not want to line up. Oh, come on. Wrong node. Let's do... Come on. Really? Alright. There we go. Yeah, it doesn't want to line up with the Rovemate probe core here. And that's real frustrating, because... I don't know. Maybe I'm a little bit of a stickler for these things. Anyway, alright, let's get this thing... Yeah, let's make sure our node is correct and we're mounting the correct direction. We are not. That is the wrongest node. Is it? God, the transparency on this thing. Okay, no, we are correct. Good, good, good. Awesome. Now we have a winch. And let's open up our... Can we... Come on, Kerbal Space Program. Let's go. Oh, I guess I'm too far away. All right. Turning back around. Inventory. Harpoons. Yes. Oh, what? Why won't you turn around? Reset. Oh, okay, there's a bounce. How? Yeah, that is obviously not going to work. We need the pointy end facing out. No. No. There. Okay, now I understand. We just have to change the surface or the attach node when it's not near the winch. Grab it. Nope. Okay. Yes. Now we got it. Harpoon loaded. Awesome. Alright. So let's just go ahead and grab the spare inventory. Slide this stuff around. There you go. Put the parachute away. Should have attached that to our junk pile instead. Now that our junk pile is too heavy to move, I guess we'll just we'll have a parachute here for no reason. Board. All right. Now then, let's let this render in. Come on, KSB. Yeah, back to work. All right. With our new harpoon gun installed, we will miss our very first shot. It will ricochet off of our junk pile and embed itself into the dirt. But our second shot works fantastically. And now we have a tow-rated Duster 1. Even better. Top speed while hauling this chunk of garbage was about 5-ish meters per second or so. But not bad until we attach something and it rejects our harpoon, but the harpoon head is recovered and we can very easily reattach it through brute force and tow our little junk pile around, collecting those last little bits of robotic parts, sometimes only able to really see them by looking for the shadows they cast ominously on the surface from way up above, even though there isn't really a shadow here. Anyway, that is our last bit of trash. So we will detach the harpoon and resecure it to the rover before detaching our battery pack from the rover after giving it a nice bit of charge and charging up that Able Avionics core. We'll drive ourselves to a minimum safe distance and set the timer for range safety. Thankfully, a little bit of time warp. We now have a final countdown. 3, 2, 1. Signal received. Detonation is complete and total, and our render times are now a whole lot smoother, especially from when we landed. But very nice to have a nice, clean, easily loadable facility that hopefully won't bounce into the pavement and blow things up. So that's going to do it for this one, everyone. Thank you so much for hanging out. I really do appreciate it. And I will see all of you in the next one. So until then, see you later.